Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Gunhawk Blood by Brad Dennison, narrated by J. Rodney Turner. Part 1. 1. Hiram McCabe arrived in town without any fanfare. He wasn't expecting any, but it did seem strange to step off the train in a town where much of his family lived and find no one waiting to greet him. No hugs, no handshakes, only strangers greeting other strangers. Hiram had a carpet bag in one hand. He carried no other luggage. He figured he would simply buy anything else he needed. After all, he didn't know how long he would be here. His business partner asked him to come here and said he would meet him within a few days. That was all he said. So here Hiram was. He was in a string tie, and his gray jacket and pinstriped trousers were made of silk. On his head was perched a matching gray bowler. He was not a self-styled cowboy, as were his father and brothers, forever wearing riding boots. His father wore boots to the table for breakfast. Hiram was in shoes, the leather of which shined. He didn't have a gun belt buckled about his hips, like his father and brothers also would have done. He carried a small Smith & Wesson .22 seven-shot revolver in a holster built into his jacket. His father had taught him how to shoot. After all, his father was the brother of Johnny McCabe, the nearly legendary gunfighter. Books were being written about Johnny. There had been a stage play in Chicago. When people heard the name McCabe, Hiram found they grew starry-eyed and wanted to know if he was related to the Johnny McCabe, or to Dusty or Tom McCabe. Tom was Hiram's brother and Dusty their cousin, and both were getting a reputation on their own. Tom was the marshal of the frontier town where Hiram now found himself. A porter on the train asked him if he was related to the McCabes. Hiram thought of saying, "Yes, I'm the one they all hate, the evil one." But instead he just shook his head. When Christmas rolled around each year, did Hiram receive Christmas cards from his father, or Tom, or their younger brother Denny? No. Not that Hiram sent any, but that was beside the point. When his legendary uncle was in California the previous summer, did he visit Hiram? The answer was equally no. Hiram heard his uncle was in town only days after the man had left. Not that Hiram necessarily wanted to see him, but every so often, when Hiram had a moment of weakness, when he was sitting alone by the fire with a glass of scotch in hand, the fact that he was alone, with no family who cared if he even existed, weighed a little heavy on him. Of course, there had been Mother. Hiram had been her favorite. But the woman essentially died of meanness and hatred, so Hiram didn't take a lot of stock in her affection for him. In San Francisco, taxis were often waiting by the train station, buggy drivers who would take you anywhere you wanted within the city, for a fee. But here, in Jubilee, Hiram glanced up and down the street and saw none. A porter was scurrying by, a young man who looked scarcely old enough to shave. "Excuse me, young man," Hiram said. The porter stopped. "Yes, sir?" "I would like to find a taxi who could take me to the livery where I might rent a buggy." The porter shrugged his shoulders with a sheepish grin. "Ain't no taxis in this town, sir. This ain't the big city, but the livery is just a few blocks down the street." Hiram was a little appalled that he was expected to walk. If the people of this town wanted his business, he expected them to show a little courtesy. "Thank you," he said to the porter and handed him 2 bits. The boy broke into a big smile. "Thank you, sir." Hiram began his walk down the stretch of wooden boardwalk to the livery. The boards creaked underfoot in places, and one time he had to step down from the boardwalk to cross the front of an alley, and he found himself walking through mud an inch deep. When he stepped onto the next boardwalk, His once shiny shoes were now desecrated with mud. He couldn't imagine why his boss wanted him to come to this town. The fact that his father lived in a nearby valley and his brother was the town marshal didn't seem relevant to him. Officially, Hiram's boss wasn't really his boss. They were business partners, owning 50-50 in the various ventures they shared. But his partner had a reputation. The man's name was Aloysius Randall, and people who stood against him seemed to either die young or simply disappear. Even though they were officially partners, when Randall said to do something, Hiram didn't. Hiram had been a little reluctant to enter into business with him, but the potential to make money was too good to refuse. Indeed, over the past 2 years, Hiram had seen his net worth increase by a full third. All Hiram knew about Randall's interest in this area was that Randall had tried to purchase the McCabe ranch more than once, and he had been refused every time. Hiram had been in Randall's office when they discussed it. Hiram had a glass of scotch in one hand. Johnny McCabe sold most of his land to the government. From what I hear, the government is setting up some sort of Indian reservation. That land no longer has any value to me. There is no possible way the government would sell you that acreage unless maybe you agreed to pay much more than the going rate. And there's no point in that. But the remaining acreage and the house would be of use. I plan to invest in mining in that area, and the house would be a good base of operations for us. Randall also held a glass of scotch, and he took a sip. I plan to beat Johnny McCabe and that blasted daughter of his. Her name is Sabrina, and they call her Bree. How incredibly quaint. Randall shuddered. They think they have beaten me, but they haven't. Hiram wasn't sure what to think. How do you plan to beat them? That's for me to figure out. But, Aloysius, there's no profit in it. That ranch is off in a remote corner of the West. Randall looked at him. My motivations are my own. And that was all he said on the matter. So here Hiram was, in Jubilee, Montana, a small town on the edge of nowhere with streets of mud and no taxis, and most of the men he saw on the street looked to be either miners or cowhands. His job was to get 2 hotel rooms and then wait for Randall. But Randall had said it would be at least a few days before he arrived, so Hiram had a little time to kill. At the livery, he rented a buggy and a horse. He climbed up onto the seat and took the reins in his hand. Then he looked at the attendant. I'm looking for the home of Matt McCabe. Could you give me directions? The attendant had a white beard and a tattered hat. He gave a slow, lazy shrug of his shoulders. Could, but it won't do you no good. Hiram was growing impatient. And why, pray tell, not? Because that there buggy you rented won't get you there. He lives halfway up a ridge, the ridge that's just east of town, about a quarter mile up Wilbury Road. You'll see a small trail that breaks off to the right. Follow that trail about halfway up the ridge, and you'll find his place. But that buggy you just rented won't make it. The suspension is too delicate. You need a buckboard, or even better, a saddle horse. Then I would like to trade in this buggy for a buckboard. The old-timer gave another slow shrug. Can't. Ain't none for rent. Folks around here own buckboards and use 'em for farm work or ranching. But they don't rent 'em. Hiram was losing his patience. Then get me a horse. The old-timer scratched his beard. I don't know, but that's a good idea. You know anything about riding? Hiram drew a breath, trying to steady his temper. It was like this old-timer was just prodding him to see his reaction. Believe me, my father made sure all his sons could ride. Now are you going to waste my time here all day, or trade me the buggy for a horse that can climb that ridge? The old man shrugged his shoulders again. Don't have to be so titchy. He went to the corral out behind the livery and dropped the loop on a roan. Want me to saddle him for you? I hate to see your nice suit get all dirty. No, I don't want to be here all day listening to you blather. I'll do it myself. The old man watched as Hiram saddled the horse. I gotta say this for you. You might have soft, lily-white hands, but you've saddled a horse before. Hiram tied his carpet bag to the back of the saddle, then he swung up and onto the back of the horse. The old man shook his head. It ain't none of my business, but... Hiram closed his eyes with defeat. What? You're gonna be riding that there horse up the side of a ridge, through stands of pines and alder. What about it? You look like you're in your Sunday go to meeting clothes. Them duds ain't gonna stand up to that kind of treatment. Then what would you recommend? I'd recommend Franklin's down the street. Hiram didn't know if he believed God existed. But if God did indeed exist, Hiram knew that God was laughing at him right now. And what, might I ask, is Franklin's? Franklin's Mercantile. Best place to buy the kind of clothes you need for the ride ahead of you. Started up by Charlie Franklin, one of the first citizens of this town. Except he don't run it no more. Run by May McCabe. McCabe? The old man nodded his head. Daughter of Johnny McCabe herself. The old man scratched his beard. Except she's gotten married. Don't think her name's McCabe anymore. Don't know that it ever was, now that I think about it. Old Johnny's family is kind of hard to keep track of. Hiram had had enough. He turned the horse away from the livery and rode on down the street. 2. Hiram stepped out of the small dressing room at Franklin's, and he now wore jeans and a new rain shirt. On his feet were black riding boots. A girl who couldn't have been much older than 12 stood by the counter. I don't know, mister. You still look like a city slicker to me. May was behind the counter. Tildy. Tildy shrugged. Well, he does. The clothes Hiram had arrived in were rolled up and tucked under one arm. He hesitated a moment at the counter, considering the ride ahead of him. The small revolver that was still in his jacket might not be sufficient. His gaze fell on 5 revolvers on a shelf behind the counter. I presume those pistols are for sale? May nodded her head. Yes, sir. I would like to see the one on the left. May fetched it for him. He spun the cylinder, making sure it was empty. Tildy said, That's a Colt 44. I know what it is. Actually, it's a 44-40. Takes the same cartridges that a lot of Winchester rifles do. That way you only have to carry one type of cartridge in your gun belt. What was it with the people in this town? I know what it is. He said to May, I'll take it, and a box of ammunition. Tildy was grinning at him. You need a gun belt, too. May gave her a look. Tildy? What? He's got a horse outside, and he's bought clothes to dress like a cowhand. He's gonna go riding. You buy a gun like that, you need a holster to put it in. She looked at Hiram. You know why men who ride horses a lot carry a pistol? He was growing weary. Yes. It ain't to shoot Indians and outlaws, though all the dime novels would make you think otherwise. I know. It's so if their horse throws them and their foot gets caught in the stirrup, they can shoot the horse and not get dragged to death. How could I possibly grow up the son of Matt McCabe and not know those things? Tildy's mouth fell open. You're the son of Matt McCabe? That makes me your cousin. Well, kinda. Johnny McCabe is kinda my father. She glanced at May. Well, our father. We have another father, too, but Johnny is kind of our father. Well, he's May's real father. That makes me your cousin. Kind of. Hiram was aggravated with himself. He hadn't intended to reveal his identity any more than was necessary. Are you ever quiet? May grinned. When she's asleep. I'm sorry, she runs off at the mouth. Tildy was looking at him. Is Matt McCabe really your father? That means you must be Hiram. Hiram produced a wallet from his jeans pocket. That's what they tell me. He paid May. Keep the change. Tildy said. But you still need a gun belt and a hat. That sun will cook your brains if you try to ride all the way to Uncle Matt's on a hot day like this with that little hat you came in here with. Hiram left the store with his old clothes tucked under one arm, a new Boss of the Plains hat pulled down over his temples, and a gun belt buckled about his hips. Wow, Tildy said to May. Can you believe it? He's our cousin. Didn't seem too friendly, though. Tildy, you have to learn not to talk so fast or so much. But look at all that stuff I sold him. May came out from behind the counter and went to a front window. She watched as Hiram McCabe tucked his rolled-up suit into the carpet bag tied to the back of his saddle. Then he mounted up and rode off down the street. For a city slicker, he looked natural in the saddle. May figured it was probably that way with all McCabe men. Tildy wasn't sure what her sister was doing. What you looking out the window for? May had heard the stories about Hiram, though she had kept them from Tildy. What could he be doing here in town? Heck stepped in from the back door. He had been splitting firewood. They would need it tonight. It was early June, and the days were warm with early summer, but the nights still got downright cold. What are you doing, May? Tildy said. She's watching her new cousin right away. May looked at Heck. Hiram McCabe is in town. That got Heck's attention. What's he doing here? May shrugged. He said he was here to see his father. Bought some clothes and a gun. Tildy bounced on her toes. I talked him into buying a gun belt and a hat. Spends money like he's got it coming out of his ears. Heck said to May, want me to run over to the marshal's office and tell Tom? She nodded her head. Might be a good idea. Tilly gave May a look, then she directed it at Heck. All right, what are you two not telling me? 3. 10 years ago, Matt brought Petty to this valley and they built a small cabin on a flat area, sort of a shelf, partway up the ridge. Within view of the cabin was a low point, almost a pass that looked like it had been cut along the summit of the ridge. Right up and through that pass, and down the other side of the ridge, and you would be in the valley. Matt had made the journey so many times that he had worn a little trail up and through the pass. Another trail led down and away from the shelf, and to a road down below that would lead into town. At one time, Matt had run one of the biggest ranches in California. Not quite as big as the Barkley Ranch outside of Stockton, but a close second. He had smoked fine cigars from Cuba, and he had conducted business from a mahogany desk in his study, often wearing a bolo tie and a pinstriped jacket. That was where he managed his empire. Though he hadn't been really managing it, he had learned over the years. His wife at the time, Berna, had been managing it the whole time, and she had been managing him like a puppet on a string. He thought about those days as he stood on the small porch in front of the cabin, a cup of coffee in one hand, looking up at the notched summit. Matt had always been the tallest of his brothers, and he had the leanest build. Not that he wasn't strong. He just didn't look it. He had taken to wearing a mustache during his years in California, when he had taken over the McCarty Ranch from Berna's father. Berna had said it made him look distinguished. He had shaved the mustache off when he left behind the ranch and that woman, and her crookedness and conniving. He thought he wanted a new beginning, and since he had ridden into California with only the clothes on his back and no mustache, and he was leaving California with the same amount of belongings, he would also do so without a mustache. In recent years, he had grown it back and had grown a goatee to match. Petty said he looked natural with whiskers. It was mid-morning, and he had already been working in the small garden where he grew crops for himself and Petty. Corn, potatoes, tomatoes, a little rhubarb. Where he had at one time been one of the most successful ranchers in California, a man who is sometimes called a cattle baron, he was now content to work his small farm. Most cattlemen looked with disdain on the work of a farmer, but Matt was finding contentment with it. It was the work he had learned on the family farm back in Pennsylvania. He felt like, in a way, his life had gone full circle. He no longer wore ties or boots that cost more than a cowhand's pay for an entire year. He was in jeans that were faded, and he wore a flannel shirt. On his feet were riding boots. He had never gone back to the type of boots farmers often wore, but they were scratched and worn. He and Petty made little money. He would sometimes sell firewood to the farmers in the valley or to folks in town. He would trade with May, firewood for a sack of coffee or sugar, or a box of ammunition. He was no expert with a gun like his brother Johnny or Johnny's son Dusty. Even Matt's own son Tom was making a name for himself with a gun. But Matt could shoot straight enough, and like his brothers, he had the ability to remain strangely calm when bullets were flying. Must run in the family, he thought. But he had never been one for trick shooting. When he wore a gun, it was a Smith & Wesson 38 caliber Model 3. Johnny, however, preferred the Colt, said it was better balanced, and maybe it was for someone with Johnny's shooting skills. Dusty and Tom used Colts too, but Matt was satisfied with his Smith & Wesson. He liked the feel of it in his hand and the way you broke it open like a shotgun to load it, rather than loading it through a side loading gate. Petty stepped out from the kitchen with a kettle of coffee. Her sandy hair now showed streaks of silver, and it was tied up into a bun behind her head. There's enough in here for one more cup, if you'd like. He grinned. I would never say no to another cup. She began pouring. You do drink a lot of coffee, but I never knew a cowhand who didn't. He shrugged his shoulders. But then, I'm not a cowhand anymore. I'm a farmer. You'll always be a cowhand at heart. He grinned and took a sip. She shook her head. Haley told me that she told you to cut down on coffee. Too much isn't good. He smiled. First thing tomorrow. He let his gaze drift back to the ridge and the notch. She said, you've been thinking about the old days, haven't you? Your life in California. He nodded his head. I can tell when you have. There's something different about the look in your eyes. He shrugged. It's hard not to think about those times. I made a big mistake with Myrna. I took a lot of years out of my life, years I won't get back. It was a long time ago. Look at the life you have now. And Tom and Danny are here with you. Matt nodded. It just haunts me sometimes. You're a good man, otherwise you wouldn't be bothered by it. But maybe you should look more at the man you are now and the life you're leading here. He nodded his head and he looked at her with a grin. I used to call Johnny morose back in the old days. Looks like I've taken after him. Don't take after him too much. She turned to head back into the kitchen. Then she turned back toward him as a thought occurred to her. Oh, don't forget, we've been invited to the ranch for supper tonight. It's been too long since we've seen everyone. That it has. Petty went back into the kitchen, and Matt returned his gaze to the wooded ridgeline. His thoughts were now on dinner at the ranch. He missed Temperance's cooking, now that she and Josh had moved to Wyoming, but Jessica's cooking was tasty. It had been too long since they had seen Johnny and Jessica, and Aunt Jenny and Sam had been invited. Petty had considered Jessica and Sam to be family long before Matt and Johnny had come into their lives. Petty came back out with a cup of tea in one hand. She stood beside him, and he reached one arm over her shoulder and pulled her in closer. That got a smile out of her. He said, maybe it's because of those days in California that I appreciate you so much. I'll admit, I think about those days too. The hard years before I met you. They come back on me at night, sometimes. I relive them in my dreams. Before she could say anything else, something caught her attention. Movement to the right and off a ways. Matt, I think we have a rider coming. He followed her gaze. His eyes weren't as good as they once were. He had taken to wearing spectacles at times, but he wondered if they really did any good. That's the trail that leads down to Wilbury Road. We hardly ever get any riders from that direction, usually from the valley, and it's usually Johnny or Dusty or Bree. Then something struck him as familiar about the rider. The way a man sits in the saddle, moving with the horse as the horse steps along, can be as unique as the way a man walks. No, it can't be. Who do you think it is? If the rider was who Matt thought he was, it was a man Matt had never expected to see again. Petty, run inside and fetch my gun belt. 4. Hiram reined up in front of the porch of the little cabin. A man he could scarcely believe was his father stood on the front porch. His father had always dressed the part of a cattle baron in California, but now he looked like a cross between a farmer and a gunfighter. Buckled about his hips was a gun belt, not the one he had used in California, which had been ornate, with swirls carved into it and conchos on the holster. This was a simple belt with a holster that looked like it might have been army surplus, with the top flap cut away. The man had a mustache and goatee that were nearly white. Lines were carved into his face. Lines Hiram didn't remember being there before. "Father," Hiram said. "Hiram, is that really you?" Hiram nodded. "Yes, indeed." "So you're calling me father again? The last time I saw you, you told me you weren't mine. You said your mother had said your father was that lackey of hers, Timmons, who used to follow her around like a dog." Hiram nodded his head reluctantly. "That's the way of it. But I grew up believing you were my father. I learned from you. I would hope I take some of that with me. What brings you to Montana? I can't believe you came all this way to tell me that." Hiram shook his head. "I'm here on business. But while I was here, I thought I would take the time to visit you. Maybe reconnect with you." "What do you do for business these days?" "I have partnered up with a man who has interest in shipping companies, banking, and land speculation." "What's his name?" Hiram found himself a little reluctant to give it. "Aloysius Randall." Matt shook his head. "The apple doesn't fall far from the tree, does it? Your mother's tree. Maybe it's best that you just ride away." "But, Father, I meant what I said the last time we talked. At least part of the blame for how you turned out is mine. Maybe most of it. I should have stood tough. I should have insisted on helping raise you, like I did with Tom and Danny. But your mother wanted to do most of it, and when it came to her, for far too long I saw what I wanted to see, and not what was really there, and you're the victim in all of it. May I get down from this horse? Maybe have a cup of coffee with you?" Matt shook his head. "Why else are you here? Everything your mother did was with a dual agenda, and you learned well from her." Hiram shrugged his shoulders and looked a little sheepish. "Well, one piece of land I'm here to research is Uncle Johnny's ranch. Maybe make an offer for it. I was hoping you could arrange a meeting between us. Maybe put in a good word for me." Matt gave a weary sigh. "Maybe it would be best if you just turned your horse around and rode back to town." "Father, the remaining acreage in the house itself are worth a fair amount of money, and Aloysius is willing to pay above market value. He wants the house to serve as our base of operations in the area. We intend to buy into some of the mines here. It would behoove Uncle Johnny to hear my offer." "I'm not going to say it again." Hiram gave a long look at Matt. Then he tugged on the reins to turn the horse, and he rode away. Matt had asked Petty to wait inside after she brought the gun belt. She stood just inside the kitchen with the door ajar, and as Hiram rode away, she stepped back outside. "I know it's hard, seeing him and the man he turned out to be. Are you all right?" Matt's gaze was on Hiram as he worked his way down the trail back toward town. "As much as I ever will be." 5. Tom McCabe sat at his desk with a stack of reward flyers in front of him. He was in a white shirt and a string tie, and the town marshal's badge was pinned to his left shirt pocket. Each one of the flyers had to be read, and then he would decide which ones to post. He reached up to rub his tired eyes. Dang, but he hated paperwork. Danny stood at the stove, pouring the last of a kettle of coffee into a cup. Tom figured the coffee had gone cold because the fire in the stove had long gone out. He had made the coffee earlier in the morning, before the heat of the day and the stove could combine to turn the office into an oven. Danny had been little more than a boy when he and Tom had left California with their father and their Uncle Johnny. Now he had filled out, mostly with muscle, but a little bit of a pot belly was starting to form. Too many of those good-tasting dinners at the Second Chance, Tom figured. Danny had a deputy's badge pinned to his shirt, and a gun belt was buckled about his hips. Some law enforcement agencies west of the Missouri were starting to wear uniforms, like the constables of St. Louis and San Francisco. But Tom thought it would be a while before the town council ponied up the money for uniforms in Jubilee. He was more than happy not to wear one anyway. Danny set the empty kettle back on the stove. Hey, Tom, it's 10 o'clock. Want me to go walk the rounds? It was Tuesday morning, as chaotic as this town could become on a Saturday night when the cowhands and miners got paid. On a weekday morning, the pace was sleepy and slow, just the way Tom liked it. He pushed away from his desk. No, I think I'll go walk 'em myself. I've had about enough paperwork. Need to rest my eyes. This job has more paperwork than I ever saw as a minister. Danny grinned. At least you don't have to wear that collar no more. Tom buckled on his gun belt. Besides, you've got your coffee to finish. Danny held up his cup. Right. It's good to have priorities. Hold down the fort, will you? Tom grabbed his hat and headed for the door. Sure thing, boss. Tom stopped in the doorway and looked back at his brother. If you get bored, don't be afraid to start going through those reward flyers. Only got about 50 of them in that stack. What? Couldn't hear you? Tom grinned. Right. He stepped out onto the boardwalk. On a Saturday afternoon, when the miners and cowhands got their monthly pay, Tom would walk around with a scattergun to show he meant business. But on a sleepy morning like this one, the Colt Peacemaker in his holster would suffice. He thought once his rounds were finished, he might stop in at the small house he and Hilly owned, over on 3rd Street. He had married Hilly 3 years ago. They had an anniversary coming up in a couple of months, and he wanted to do something special for it, but he didn't know what he could do on a marshal's salary. He had been married years ago to a woman by the name of Leticia, but he had called her Letty. She had been happy as the wife of a Methodist minister, but not as the wife of a lawman. She was honest enough with herself to admit she had married the profession and not the man, but that didn't make the divorce any easier on their daughter Mercy. As a Christian, Tom didn't believe in divorce. Even more, since he had been a minister when he first came to this town, he thought he had to set an example. And yet, he had signed the divorce papers. He was surprised at how little he felt when he signed them. Apparently, his love for her had been fading without him even being aware of it. He was even more surprised that when Letty left for Ohio to live with her mother, she didn't want to take Mercy with her. Letty had said she intended to have Christmas with Mercy if the trails were open. The railroad hadn't yet reached Jubilee, and as Tom had expected, the trails were closed by November, with the heavy snowfall that got dropped on them in the mountains of Montana. Letty then wrote that she would instead be in town for Mercy's birthday in June. Turned out she didn't do that either. An aunt was sick in Ohio, and Letty said she was needed there. At first, Letty wrote long letters to Mercy. Because Mercy had been young and couldn't yet read cursive handwriting, Tom read them to her. Letters filled with a mother's love, a mother who missed her daughter. As time passed, the letters became fewer and shorter. Mercy now received maybe one or two a year. and she had not seen her mother since the day her mother boarded a stagecoach to head for Ohio. Hilly had come into their lives a few months after Letty left. Hilly was the new schoolmarm who didn't look the way Tom remembered schoolmarms looking when he was a kid. Blue eyes, hair the color of straw, a smile that stopped him cold and made him forget to breathe. Hilly had stolen Tom's heart the first time he looked at her, and it wasn't long before she was spending evenings with Tom and Mercy, joining their lives like she belonged there. One day, Mercy said to him, "Pa, when are you going to ask Miss Hilly to marry you?" It was over breakfast, and it caught him a little off guard. Well, such things have to be thought about long in advance, and you have to know the woman really well before you can ask her something like that. "Well, Pa, you wait too long when someone else might come along and snatch her up." "Oh, Mercy, I don't think that'll happen." She shrugged her shoulders. "I don't know. She's a real winner." That evening, he asked Hilly to marry him. Mercy was growing up faster than he thought was possible. Every morning, he expected an 8-year-old to come out of her bedroom, but the girl who emerged was 15. A young man who worked at the assayer's office had taken a shine to her, and they had shared more than one dance at a shindig a few weeks ago. During a waltz, Tom had thought they were dancing too close together and was about to intervene, when Hilly put a hand on his arm. "Leave it be. They're fine. She's a young woman now." That night, as Tom finally got to stretch out in bed and let his head sink into the pillow, he thought about how Hilly had taken over much of the role of Mercy's mother. "I'm grateful for you, you know that? You have stepped in, filling Letty's shoes. That was never required. Any child of yours is a child of mine. You have made such a difference in her life. I want you to know that. You have in my life, too. But the good you have done her goes beyond words." He could tell she was smiling by the way she formed her words. "You have both brought so much to my life, too." He found he was also smiling. Maybe that's the way it's meant to work. All of this was running through Tom's mind as he stepped along the boardwalk. His heels thunked along the boards underfoot, and his spurs jingled a little with each step. The town was made up mostly of buildings that had been slapped together in a hurry with 2x4s and planks, like with most boom towns. Some of the roof lines were a little uneven, and more than one window wasn't lined up quite right. Some boom towns faded after a while, but others had longevity, and Tom thought Jubilee was showing itself to be in the second group. A train station had been built of brick and mortar. The railroad company intended for the station to be here for a while. Across from Tom's office had been a ramshackle structure that served as home to an oddities and trinket shop. The building had been taken down, and a new one was going up that had a solid foundation of granite slabs, and it also had brick siding. The bank in town was now also a solid building, and it had a steel vault that had been shipped out all the way from St. Louis. All signs that Jubilee was growing from a boomtown into a community that would stand for years. As Tom walked along, he heard the call of the morning train. When he got to the train station, he glanced at the small crowd on the platform, some folks arriving and others getting ready to board. One man stepped down from the platform to the boardwalk. He looked to be about 30 and had long hair and a neatly trimmed goatee and a long, dark gray duster coat. Tom knew the man. Though the last time Tom had seen him, the man's beard had looked like a wild-growing bush, and there had been nothing neatly trimmed about him. "Gabe Quint, if I'm not mistaken." The man squinted his eyes as he looked at Tom from under a black, wide-brimmed hat with a flat crown. "Why, Sheriff McCabe, I heard you were still running things up here in Jubilee." Quint had a carpet bag in one hand and the other held a double-barreled shotgun. Tom said, "Last time I saw you, I told you to leave town or you'd be facing 30 days in jail. That's what Judge Mack decided." Quint shook his head. "That old whiskey-swilling judge don't scare me none. Besides, I'm here on business. The company I work for sent me." Tom didn't find this man amusing at all. That a fact? Yes, indeed. How long are you planning to stay? As long as I need to get the job done. Quint moved a step around Tom, and Tom sidestepped into his way. And what might that job be? Land acquisition. I'm a land speculator. Or at least I work for one. Tom chuckled. You? A land speculator? You're a back-shooting gun for hire. Can you even sign your name? Get out of my way, McCabe. I ain't broke no laws. You got involved in a saloon brawl at the second chance that turned into a shooting match. You killed two men. They were shooting at me. Besides, you said there would be no charges filed against me if I left town. I said if you left town and didn't come back. All right, then arrest me. That incident was almost 4 years ago. Doubt there's anyone left here in town who could serve as a witness. Hunter, the saloon owner. Them charges won't stick. The company I work for has got good lawyers and lots of money. And who do you work for? Singleton Property Development. Ever heard of us? Tom had to think for a moment. The name sounded familiar, but he wasn't sure where he had heard it. Quint looked at him. Now who's the stupid one? They're only fast becoming the biggest land company in California, spreading their wings a bit into Texas and all the way up here to Montana.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.